Cassandra NoSQL overview session. So this session is gonna roughly about 2.5 hours and less than 3 hours. We'll try to keep it as simple and compact as possible and try to get you all the best possible answers and clarifications over this presentation. So the best time to ask any questions is when you have got it. So please feel free to interrupt in between and put your questions in the questions window. So my name is Nagarajan. I work as an application architect for e-commerce company, and I will be sharing some of the knowledge what we have gained over the Cassandra usage in our day-to-day life. So the course structure is roughly categorized into 8 modules. So we'll be looking into the module 1, the class 1, providing the basic overview of what Cassandra is today, and in the following classes or in the modules, followed by the second module, understanding the Cassandra data model, and in module 3 we'll be talking about its internal architecture and design, followed by module 4, creating a sample application, how do we build a simple application using Cassandra and play around with that sample application. We'll follow some of the configuration, monitoring and maintenance along with tuning aspects of Cassandra in module 5. We'll also try to explore some of the options what we have got, how do we integrate with the Hadoop and HDFS file system in module 6. In module 7 we'll follow some of the CURD DDL and DML operations, followed by ending with a live project which we can take up and try to see how do we build applications using Cassandra. So quickly jumping on to the module 1 for today's class, what we're going to cover is basically we're going to talk about what are the challenges we can face with traditional RDBMSs in building big data applications or big data solutions. So what are the trade-offs we need to consider, like consistency, availability and partition tolerance. When we talk about this, we're also going to talk about the CAP theorem, and we're also going to explore some of the NoSQL offerings, what and all is the possible options we have got to build a big data NoSQL solutions. And then we're going to start off with exploring the Cassandra basic overview of it and the use cases of Cassandra, what features it offers, and what kind of features like tunable consistency, architecture, and some of the overview concepts of it. At the end, we'll going to spend some time in demonstrating some of the key aspects of Cassandra by using a demo application, and followed by Q&A session at the end. But we will also encourage you to ask any questions in between, and I'll be happy to take them in between. So let's just quickly jump on to see an overview of what module 2 would be focusing on. So the module 2 would be in understanding the database model, what is the contrast between the RDBMS terminology in Cassandra, how do we use the database concepts and how do we use it in Cassandra kind of things. So we'll focus on some of the database aspects in Cassandra. What is a cluster, what is a key space, what are the column families, what are super column families, what are the rows, what are the indexes in Cassandra, primary keys and the composite keys, the primary differences between RDBMS and Cassandra, what are the materialized views, columns, aggregate keys kind of thing. So this is a little bit more extensive, in-depth kind of discussion based on the database model, what Cassandra can offer. So in module 3 or class 3, we'll be trying to focus a majority of our time in understanding the architecture and the design aspects of Cassandra. We're going to learn the internal working subcomponents and the submodules, what it offers, what are the system data spaces or the key spaces, what are the communication models, what is peer-to-peer architecture like gossip protocols and all those things. We're going to learn how Cassandra offers high availability and tolerance using failure detections in the nodes, and how do it handles data repairs and the internal communication mechanisms or models. We're going to focus on some of the aspects like memtable, SS table and commit logs, and some of the internal component process flow, how it handles and how it works. And we're going to focus a little bit on what hinted handoff is, compaction, bloom filters like tombstones, and the architecture model what Cassandra offers, the staged event-driven architecture. We're going to focus on the layers of how it has been built and how we can work with these kind of architectures. Finally, we're going to talk about some of the aspects taking it to module 4, like what are the real challenges, what are the non-functional or functional challenges you cannot build or scale applications using RDBMS, what are the possible alternative solutions is available in the market where you can pick one of these solutions and make sure you build the right applications using the right solutions. And we will also do a detailed discussion on brainstorming the rationale behind choosing a Cassandra for the right use case and for the right application. And followed by, we'll also spend time in differentiating the data models from Cassandra versus traditional RDBMSs, what could be the various data models or data structures each one of them offers, and how do we handle the data models and the data structures. Basically, followed by some of the queries, or what are the queries we can use to design the data model in Cassandra, apply those models to various use cases, create a sample application involving all the types of data and data models, and we will extend the discussions, whatever we have been done in class 2 or module 2 in this module. And then we're going to do some sort of batch or processing, doing some batch searches kind of scenarios in this sample application, where we're going to do a complete end-to-end scenario-based walkthrough in the problem, what we're going to pick it up. We're going to also focus on various detailed aspects of Cassandra, like the replication factors, the replication strategies, the partitioners, the key spaces, and the column families, how it has to be handled using snitches, and how to configure a cluster. Very detailed discussions of how you're going to configure all these things in Cassandra configuration, and what kind of security Cassandra offers to control the data access and the communication aspects of any client-server interaction with the data store. And we're going to spend some time in understanding what are the monitoring tools and what are things are required to monitor. And we're going to spend a lot of time in the maintenance aspect, what a ring cluster could be, how do you do basic maintenance, how do you do upgrades, how do you take snapshots, how do you do load balancing, how do you decommission and update nodes for any patches or any updates kind of thing. And finally, we will be ending this module on fine-tuning the performance aspect of it. So in some cases you might need to spend a little bit time on fine-tuning the memory, the data model, the data storage, the timeout settings, the quorum settings, the replication settings. So in the first go you might not get everything right, so you might just fine-tune it over the period of time. So we'll be spending some time in understanding based on the use case and based on the requirements. In module 6, class 6, we will be focusing or contrasting our class with Hadoop. Basically, we will try to give a quick overview of what Hadoop is, what HDFS is, and what MapReduce is, and basically how do we work with Cassandra on top of Hadoop, or integrating both of these, or leveraging the outcome or the data from HDFS with Cassandra, and do we make sure we leverage the platforms which is already existing on Hadoop or on Cassandra or vice versa. So we'll spend some time on understanding the PigLatin and the HiveQL, and we'll see how we can integrate or interact with Cassandra to make sure we leverage the existing platforms or the existing MapReduce scripts. So that's pretty much what we will do in module 6. The class 7 will focus on pure CURD operations. Basically, how do you read data in Cassandra? What is Thrift API? What are slice predicates? What is the options you have got in DDL? What is the operations or the features you have got in DML? We'll try to execute some SQL scripts. SQL is basically a Cassandra query language, and you can run it that from either command prompt or through code. And we're going to create and modify some users who are going to interact with that system. We're going to try to understand some of the mutates, mutates and the batch deletes. And we're going to also have a little bit more emphasis on security configurations and working with the data sets on using SQL or Thrift and import, export data with SQL kind of options. The last module for this course, we will focus on a live project. This would be a much more real-time scenario and real-time application, which we will pick it up based on all the learnings from the last 7 modules, and we'll implement and use each one of those concepts and try to demonstrate how these concepts work in real-time applications. So this will be an end-to-end project where we can all spend time in building, troubleshooting, and trying to reconfigure, optimize kind of exercise. So that's pretty much what we have got for this entire course structure. So let's quickly jump on to the first class course, what we're going to spend time in understanding and try to discuss here. So basically, we're going to spend time in understanding what are the problems traditional RDBMS will pose challenge in building a big data scale applications or building high volume, high available distributed storage solution for any e-commerce or a high volume transaction applications. So what are the trade-offs you need to consider while building these applications? The key aspects could be like the consistency, availability, the partition tolerance. And we will have some detailed discussion on the CAP theorem, what it is, what it recommends, and how do we leverage this theory to choose the right storage platform to build any of the big data NoSQL solutions. And we'll also try to dig a little bit into what are the different flavors of NoSQL offerings are there, and what are the solutions we can pick from for what kind of solution it is better. So basically, we're going to spend more time on understanding all the high-level concepts and a little bit in details of what Cassandra is. We're going to spend a lot of time in understanding the use cases where the Cassandra can be useful. We're going to spend some of our time in understanding the features like tunable consistency, the architecture, the elastic scalability, the column orientation aspects of it. And ending for this class, we will have a small demo of showcasing how exactly we're going to try to build applications using a Thrift client to build, connect to a cluster, populate some data, read some data, and update some data. So even at the end, we'll block some time for final Q&A sessions, and we'll be wrapping up the session. So that's what we're going to follow. So what we're going to do is basically we're going to focus on a storyline, and we're going to build a storyline for this presentation. So the storyline is, say, for example, I'm having a Twitter account, and I'm trying to, say, contact Angelina Jolie and trying to date Angelina Jolie, and maybe I'll try to take her to the places where she would like, and then see if I can make this dating happen. So basically, that's the storyline, and during the storyline, what I would like to focus is what and all the tools we would require and what kind of tools we would require in what kind of scenarios. So that's the storyline we are trying to build, and all these tools or all these applications might involve massive data scale and high availability applications. So we'll focus on the areas and the tools where we would need a different strategy versus a different tool kind of approach. So since my intent is to go and date Angelina Jolie, so what I would do is basically, since I have already contacted her, and I would like to just make sure we meet up in a common place, the first thing I would like to do is maybe I will just go and book a flight and book a hotel to just make sure I just go and get some place where we can meet up each other. So what happens in this particular scenario is maybe I'll choose one of the travel sites like Expedia or Cleartrip or Yatra. The first thing I do is go and search a particular destination or a location where I can get all the prices or all the availability for a particular flight or a hotel. So the first thing what happens here is when I enter a particular destination, in some cases I'll be either asked to select all these destinations, or I'll be typing some of the keywords where I can get some recommendations for the destination based on the keywords I have typed. So the first thing is I'll be going and searching in my data store. Primarily, majority of the applications, they use some sort of a bit vector searches like Solr or Lucene to search the tokens and then get a list of destinations or the list of keys where I can go and display to the user these are the prices or these are the availability. So in this data store, I might not store all the prices or the availability for any flight or a hotel. I will only store the destination names and the mappings of a particular IDs or some sort of a keys. So once I have all the destinations and some user selects a particular destination, the first thing basically everyone does is just go and pick those keys or item IDs or hotel IDs in the context of whether it is a hotel or a flight, pick those as keys and then go and use another data store or another table or a fast cache kind of solution where you go and fetch all the availability for a given dates. A user might give dates that I need prices or the availability based on these dates. So I might go and just fetch all the information and display it on the page. So the key aspect what comes out here is basically there are majority of the users what they need is I need the price and availability as fast as possible. So for this kind of applications, the key requirement is there is a huge data scale, and when you have a huge data scale, the data has to be distributed and it has to be partitioned. So if you don't partition the data or if you don't distribute the data, handling the data in a huge pile of information in one centralized location, searching that data is time-consuming process and it is a very tedious process. Instead of that, distribute the data so that you can search faster and you can update faster, and all this distributed data has to be available in a real-time fashion all the time, 100% of the time. So the key thing is basically the scale, the distribution, and the availability. So that's the primary requirement for this particular step. Once I go and select a particular inventory like hotel or a flight or a movie which I'm trying to book, what happens is basically this is a different page or a different screen or a different UI altogether. Here the requirement is not speed, it's the requirement has to be consistency. The reason why it has to be consistency, the primary requirement is consistency. Basically, if you don't focus on consistency, there are chances that any user will go and have a duplicate bookings for the same inventory. So for a flight or a hotel or for a movie, you always need to have the consistency as the key aspect while you're trying to book a particular inventory. And the secondary aspect could be like the data scale. With all the possible combinations of the flight combinations, the hotel combinations across the globe, with all the movie seats or the inventory reservation, the data distribution with consistency becomes a key aspect of it. So in these cases, basically what we could do is basically we can use the technologies or the tools like your traditional RDBMS or MongoDB kind of storage solutions where it provides consistency levels much more higher than tools like where you can have very little consistency like Cassandra. Eventually provides consistency. The first option of displaying the results with Cassandra will be much more faster and much more efficient. When it comes to the booking kind of a state or a booking kind of a UI, the RDBMS or the MongoDB kind of storage solutions might be a little bit a better fit. So we're going to discuss these kind of things in detail and contrast each other over the course of next hour or so. So once I have selected a particular hotel and flight and I've booked the hotel flight along with some movie tickets and all. So the last thing I have to do is once I'm done with my dating, I'll just try to see, I'll just go and find some nearby restaurants for dinner or for lunch, and then we'll wrap up the entire dating session. So what I would do is I would use some tool or some Facebook kind of a thing to locate the restaurants nearby the destination I have picked. Say we have decided to say Dallas-Fort Worth in US, and we have booked a hotel and we have planned for a movie and followed by a dinner. So I need to know all the restaurants near my hotel in Dallas-Fort Worth. So these kind of applications, what it requires is basically the fast and complex querying capabilities, and it has to have a relational data model. So when I say relational data model, it has to store all the nodes or entities and store its relation between each nodes. Say for example, people in say Twitter application could be a node, and say who is following who could be a relation or an edge. And for me to query like all the people whom Angelina Jolie is following, there could be a query or a number of edges I need to fetch and display on the page. Similarly for the restaurant. So a location, say in Dallas-Fort Worth, like South Lake could be a node, and all the nearby restaurants could be all the other nodes around it. But the relation or the edge between Dallas South Lake is a node and restaurants, there should be a relation called, okay, South Lake nearby restaurants or Chinese restaurants. That relation is the key important fact when we process this kind of data for fast and complex graph kind of a query. So these kind of data structures allow fast and flexible data storage and retrieval and reading kind of data model. So the key aspect in this thing is basically you have to have still that fastness, but it's a different need altogether. So the same data model or one solution fits all the size might not work. So different solutions are required to build different use cases or different applications. So that's the crux of this entire storyline. So once I'm done with, say, the dating aspects of it, so I just wanted to go and catch up with Angelina Jolie and say, hey, how was the hangover and how did it go, what is your thoughts, and just exploring the further options with the dating, whatever happened. So in this case, I'm gonna use some sort of a chat. In this case, I've picked up, say, Facebook Messenger, and I'm trying to chat with her. So if you see the options, what I've got here is, first I need to either go and chat with her, and along with some of the conversations, I may need to process this information for further retrieval or further exploring what was the chat history and the conversations. Here again, the chat kind of applications deal with a huge data scale because it will be multiple users across the globe handling multiple data sessions. So the data scale will be pretty huge, and you need to have that level of sequence consistency where all the messages are presented in the same sequence. It should not be like, okay, I'm entering something and it has been presented later with all wrong order. So the ordering and the sequential consistency is much more important in these kind of applications. There are a lot of technologies we could explore. Some of these things can be built using, like, say, H-based kind of application, or we could explore some of the other aspects. So the key thing is not which tool right here. So is the aspect which is critical, like consistency and the data scale. So we have seen different use cases. The one thing which comes out common across all these applications or all these scenarios is everything is being done in a huge data volume. So the data scale these applications or these tools needs to handle is way too high. It's in petabytes, it's in more than few hundreds of terabytes. They need to process and they need to crunch and handle that kind of volume. So other thing is the data access and the data processing, like reads and writes, it has to be as fast as possible, near real time, and it has to support all random fast reads and writes. So otherwise, if you have very high turnaround time in reading or writing data, it is not sufficient for the real time applications to engage the users or the end users to work around those tools for longer time. So it has to be very fast, and you also need a lot of flexibility while building these applications. Like, you cannot have a very strong, stringent syntax models like traditional RDBMSs, where, say, in case if I need to add a column at runtime, instead of going and altering the table, reindexing all the data objects what traditional RDBMS is holding, and then recompiling those stored procs, all those things is a time consuming, and there is some level of downtime because you have to readjust your application based on your data structure changes. So that is a time-consuming process, and it's going to take some downtime with your application as well as with your data store. So you need to have a flexible storage. You need to have a flexible schema where you can work with these data models at runtime without even altering anything and bringing the application or the data storage to halt. Since you are handling with a huge, humongous data volume and big data solutions, there is a strong requirement of compression techniques of your data and the communication models. So basically, there will be a strong need for compression in the data and the data being exchanged across the nodes or across the client and server. So that also becomes a key requirement. And as we spoke about, the availability is one of the key things across all these tools, followed by consistency and distribution. So these three things is across all these tools. So it may be in one of the scenarios, the availability consistency was the primary thing, and in other aspect, the distribution or the data partition with availability was the key thing in our listing page. When we went to the booking page, the consistency and availability was the key thing. And when we have a lot of data, the consistency and distribution was the key thing. So there are a lot of common things, but it scatters around. So we said we will talk about the CAP theorem or the CAP rule, what it is exactly. So this is one of the misinterpreted concept across majority of the folks. So let's spend some time in understanding what exactly is it. So what CAP theorem says is, if you have three key aspects of your system or solution like consistency, availability, and partition tolerance, you can only choose two of these three. So what it means is basically, say for example, for my application, consistency is the key requirement that my data reads and writes has to be always consistent, and you can only choose either availability or partition. You cannot choose both of them. When we say choose, that only one of them can be the key primary requirement. The other has to be sacrificed in some or the other way. So basically, for say any traditional RDBMSs, the consistency is the key aspect, and followed by availability, where it provides some sort of availability as a secondary requirement, and you can also do some sort of partitioning or the data distribution in traditional RDBMSs, like having global partitions versus local partitions, and distribute the data across different nodes to a certain extent. But it may not provide to an extent of what other NoSQL offerings like Cassandra or MongoDB or a HBase or Redis kind of a distribution technologies offers. So basically, if you pick up the consistency and partition and you are okay sacrificing, say, availability, so basically what happens here is, in this case, you might need to sacrifice the availability aspects of it a little bit. When I say availability, let's pick a use case like MongoDB or Hadoop or HBase. So here, MongoDB offers you the immediate consistency levels, but you may need to sacrifice on the high availability and some of the aspects of fault tolerance. When we pick, say, partition tolerance and say availability, then you may need to sacrifice some of the aspects or some portion of the consistency levels. Like Cassandra eventually offers the consistency levels, but you can tune it to the strong consistency. We're going to spend some time in understanding what exactly the consistency levels, what Cassandra offers kind of thing. So these are the three key aspects what you need to be considering when you choose or you are adapting a new data store technology. So if your key requirement is consistency and availability, go for always traditional RDBMSs, which offers you the consistency at the level of transaction, and you can have all checkpoints, save points, you can roll back, you can control the consistency at the lowest data block level. If your requirement is consistency partitions, choose one of these technologies like HBase, Hypertable, Redis, MongoDB kind of thing. If your requirement is partition and availability, so choose one of these like Cassandra, CouchDB, DynamoDB, and React kind of storage solutions. So maybe we'll just take a quick Q&A so that we can see. So I have a question from Ashokan R. So the question is, what sharding meant? Okay, so basically, the sharding, what it means is you can distribute the data. Say, for example, if you have records from, say, 1 to 10. So just for simplicity, I have taken records 1 to 10. Let's assume you have records from 1 to 10 billion. So you cannot store all these records in one physical table or in one physical machine. Even though you might have the capability of storing everything, if you are reading humongous reads and writes, what happens in traditional RDBMS is, say for example, you have a key. The key has to be searched first. The first operation is you have to do a scan in a huge pile of records and go and get that particular record and return it to the user. If you have everything in one place, scanning that huge terabytes of records and say 1 billion records is technically challenging. So what people have brought up new ideas is, instead of storing it everything in one place, the same table, the same record can be stored in multiple places. So you distribute, say, from 1 to 3 in say machine 1, 3 to 4 in say machine 2, say 5 to 6 or 8 billion in say another machine, and you have chunked or sliced all these information into different sets or different batches and distribute it into different physical machines where you have smaller set of data sets instead of handling everything in a bigger set. So that is what sharding or partitioning is basically meant. And there are different techniques what people used to use prior to all these NoSQL offerings. People used to have application shards where the application will figure out, you'll have physical replication data where application used to decide which server, which physical location it used to go. So basically all these are meant for data partitioning or partition tolerance. So you distribute the data so that you always work on smaller chunks instead of working on a bigger data set. So that's what sharding is meant. Okay, so let's jump on to the next section. So we're gonna spend some time in understanding what NoSQL is. Okay, so I think I have got another interesting question from Mihir. Can you explain cap theorem with an example? So that's really interesting. So what as what I defined, what cap theorem is, you can choose either two of them. So let's say, for example, I have a use case where the same example, we could pick the flight booking or the hotel booking, where I'll go first search, see all the list of hotel prices or the flight prices available to me. So in this case, what happens is basically I need to choose the high availability and the data partitioning. The reason why I have to choose high availability and data partitioning followed by secondary aspect as consistency is, with flights and the hotels, there is humongous combinations of data. So there are thousands and millions of flights flying around the globe, and there are millions of hotels across the globe with every day different product combinations. So the data volume is humongous. So you'll be having more than few hundreds of terabytes of information which needs to be handled. So the key requirement becomes for this particular use case is you have to partition the data and distribute the data. So that's what the first key requirement. And next, I would say, okay, I would like to pick high availability because I need to respond to the user queries as quickly and as fast as possible. So with the same use case, all I need to do is just display the information as fast as possible. Say, for example, I don't need to worry about the consistency. If something is changing in the time order in the back end, that is absolutely fine because I would always consider that it had happened after I have fetched that information. So consistency could be the secondary factor in this aspect when I'm choosing the high availability and the data distribution as my key requirements. So in that case, so the consistency goes to the backstage and I'm picking up the partition and the high availability for that list page. And in other cases, in the next step when I'm booking, say for example, the consistency and availability becomes the key aspect. In the booking, I cannot overbook a particular flight or a hotel. So I need to choose a particular storage technology which can offer the consistency or the atomic operations at the basic block level. So you cannot allow anyone else to do parallel updates or parallel reads happening on the block when someone is trying to update. So the synchronization, the locking, and the threading all has to be taken care of by the data storage providing solutions. In this case, the RDBMS is the most powerful, up-to-date, which can provide the strongest consistency levels where you can do all the rollbacks, transactions, checkpoints, save points, and it can also provide the availability, very high available kind of thing. So these are the two examples I would like to present so that you can get a clear representation of how do I use the CAP theorem in these two examples. So I hope that gives some good understanding of what exactly it does. Okay, so we have another question from Subita Vattal. So what are the prerequisites regarding Cassandra? Okay, so if the context is basically what should I know so that I can start using Cassandra? So you need to have a good understanding of what NoSQL technologies are, what are the categories, and what is my business requirements, what is my functional and non-functional requirements. So once you are clearly aware of what is my functional requirements, like what is my querying capabilities, what kind of data I'm storing, what kind of data I'm reading, what kind of data I'm writing, what is the volume of reads and what is the volume of writes when it comes to non-functional requirements, whether it is it has to be a high available system, it has to be highly consistent system. So based on all these things, you can start adapting Cassandra if your requirement is based on data distributed with for high volume and it has to be available all the time. And if you are a developer, you need to be aware of these terminologies and technologies, the internal workings, and how do you build applications around Cassandra. So primarily, you need to know some of all these workings and the concepts. Apart from that, you also need to know one or the other any modern day language like Java, C Sharp, or Perl to make sure you build applications around it. So that's what I would keep it for this session. So there will be a lot of sessions, upcoming sessions, which will make sure you get all the prerequisite things before you can go and dive into Cassandra applications and make sure you build applications with it. Okay, so there is another question from Akshay BR. So please explain briefly what is partition tolerance. So I've said basically there is a strong requirement that your data needs to be distributed. Say for example, when your data is distributed, the machines or the nodes are always bound to have failures, and it is expected that your machines will go down and come back. So when you are distributing the data in partitions, you have to have minimum level of tolerance that when the machines are going down and coming up, you have at least some level of data which has to be always available in your cluster or in your server, and make sure this data or this partitions which is available when the nodes went down or when it is coming up, they are all consistent. So Cassandra offers this level of consistency, what we call it, eventual consistency in the data, and also we can fine-tune when you choose partition tolerance and when the data is distributed. So you need to have that seamless visibility to the client or the user who is reading and writing the data. You should not get old or stale data or corrupt data when your data is distributed. So your partition should be tolerant and should accept all failures and make sure it should gracefully bring down a data node or gracefully brings up a node when it comes up, or add any number of nodes. So that's what we could use for this couple of questions. Okay, so I have another question from Ashokan R. So how does sharding differ from replication? So replication is basically duplicating your data, and you define how many number of duplicates you can keep it. So basically, it is more, they all go in hand. So if I say I need to have, say, 3 data blocks replicated in my 10-node cluster, so you use the replication concept or the aspect to define what exactly a replication should be, how many number of duplicates it is. So what sharding is, basically, it is a co-aspect of your replication. What it does is basically, how do I use my partition when I have to place, say, three data nodes with my replication factor of 3, how do I choose which nodes and which data blocks goes in which servers? Because if you have replication factor of 3, you might have 10 nodes, so I need to choose on which shards or on which nodes I need to put these data blocks. So these are the techniques, what we call it as partitions or shardings. So we'll get into the details of what would be the partition strategy when we have a replication model of 3 in a cluster of 10. So we'll be going into the details of it. So that's a basic difference between what partition or shards from replication factor is. Okay, so I have another question from Yogesh Prabhu. What about HP Vertica in terms of consistency, availability, and partition clone? I think this is one of the things HP has been trying to come up with, where you can have a midpoint of consistency, availability, and partition clone. So this is one of the commercial products, if I'm not wrong, where it offers, it is trying to bring to a midpoint and try to offer all these in a mixed model. So the challenge with any one of these kind of technologies is the way it has been architected. Say, for example, if you pick one of the Hadoop kind of implementations, or big data implementations of like HP Vertica kind of things. So say, for example, we have, say, any architecture which is built on master slave. So the master slave architectures always has this drawback of having low availability models versus, say, very high availability models. So say, for example, your master regions or your master nodes has any issues, the cluster availability goes down. And you have to always make sure the master regions or the master set of the data processing capabilities is always up and running. So basically, that's a pretty basic difference what I would define, the way it has to be architected and the way you can choose the best possible mix. So some of these technologies choose either one of two, or some of them, they try to fine-tune this into a midpoint. So let's just quickly jump on to the NoSQL landscape and see what are the categories offerings we have got in NoSQL. So Basically, what NoSQL is all about, NoSQL is a momentum and it's just a tag. It's not to do anything with don't use NoSQL, don't use SQL or not SQL or it's not SQL. So it doesn't mean or intend to say anything like that. So it was a Twitter tag used by a guy who used to conduct a conference and forums for describing all these upcoming technologies, and thereafter the NoSQL become the standard nomenclature to group all these NoSQL big data offerings. So that's pretty much what NoSQL is all about. So when it comes to different storage solutions which is offering all sorts of different features, there are primarily four categories. So the first one is the key value store. In the key value store, basically what it does is basically if you have a key and if you have a value which can be read and written using a particular key or a hook, you can use a key value store and you can store or you can read and update that value as an entire object or an entire value object. So you cannot go and make partial updates or partial reads from that particular value object. So use a key, get that entire value and get that data store and work with that data object. So the key values scale much more faster and it's much more flexible. Some of the implementations like React, Basho React, the Membase and Voldemort, these are some of the example implementations of the key value data stores where the key value access is much more faster. The basic concept behind is like a hash map where you have a hash map in your local environment. If you take Java, the hash map resides in the local JVM, and that hash map you can store any object using a key. So this is just extension of it. The hash map is distributed across all the machines. You read and write in any machine using a particular key. So the internal architecture of the key value store figures out which node or which physical machine to go and hit and fetch the information. So the second category or the second type is basically an extension of the key value store. Basically it is like a big table or the column family category where you still use a key to read and update information, but the chain, the only variation is instead of reading and writing all the objects in one go, so the entire object for all the rows in one go, it is allowed to go and update or read the partial data of a row. So the partial data is segregated into columns, so that's the reason it's also given a column family kind of a data category, data storage category, where you can either update few sections of that row as columns and read few sections of that row as columns. So some of the implementations are Cassandra, HBase, Hypertable. So all these are derived on the Google Bigtable specs and it provides partial updates on the row data. So the third category or the third type is basically the document-based database where, say for example, this also is a another extension of the column family and the key value, but there is another flavor or the variant to it is basically if you don't want to read always the records using keys, it might allow, it allows you to basically read the information from the data what is stored or the partial data is stored in the document. Say for example, just to give a visualization of what exactly it is, so basically what it does is, say for example, if you are storing all persons in a database and you wanted to know and in a particular state what are the minority of the population which exist in a particular state. So what happens is, in this case, I don't know the exact keys. So what I would do is I would store this in a document object data store where my document could be three elements. One could be the city or state and the other one could be age. And I will try to group based on the city and the age group. So how exactly this happens is basically when you add a document, say for example in MongoDB, it's more of a JSON document, so you can just go and pick one or two elements from the JSON entire document, index on those, say city, state, and say age columns or elements, and then keep it ready for any further read or write operations, because when the data is indexed, it is indexed on a B-tree data structure. The B-tree data structures are fast enough to go and search in particular node and update or read that node. So the same concept is basically used in traditional RDBMSs where it uses B-trees. B-trees are faster to read and write to locate a particular node, but B-trees are not good enough when you are having huge number of writes and you have to keep on reindexing those indexes, because if you are keep on reindexing, the majority of the time will be spent on reindexing and you'll have very poor performance on the reads, because your reads has to wait till the reindexing is complete, because it has to reindex that entire B tree. And moreover, if you have more options of reading on one particular column or one particular data element without knowing the keys, you should be using something of this sort. The third category or the third type is basically the graph databases. In our example, we have seen, I was trying to locate, when I was trying to date Angelina Jolie, I was trying to locate the nearby restaurants or the nearby Chinese restaurants which we would like to go for a dinner. So in these cases, there has to be huge number of nodes and huge number of edges and relationship which has to be stored for prefetching the information at real time as quickly as possible. So all these information, the graphs, the kind of trees, it's now, this is not a binary tree. In this kind of data structure, the data stores, the B-trees won't work. B-trees is always select binaries. It's like one or here or there. So in relationships, it cannot be a binary tree. It has to be a graph where it can jump from one node to the other node or other node to the other node based on the traversal path. So there has to be relationships which has to be stored, and the data stores like FlockDB, which has been incubated by Twitter, the Neo4j kind of applications will be able to support these kind of graph kind of requirements much more efficiently. So basically, roughly these are the four categories. Depending on your use case, functional and non-functional needs, you may choose one of these categories and pick one of these technologies to use. So all these categories, when it comes to the performance and the scale, the key value stores performs better than any of these categories, and it provides the best scalable and speed performance compared to all of the remaining categories. The reason why this category scales and provides the best speed is because you are only doing atomic operations on key and value objects. That's the reason it can provide you that level of scale and speed. So when it comes to the speed and performance, the next thing which stands in the queue is the column family kind of storage solutions, or big data kind of storage big table kind of storage solution. So Cassandra falls into this on a high note. Basically, it can offer you performance, it can offer you scalability, and it can offer you the speed, where the remaining two can have little bit challenges in providing those kind of things. So in the third category, we spoke about the document. This offers the lowest of the later two categories, because since this is providing you the immediate consistency aspect, you have to sacrifice some of the scalability and speed aspect of it. So you have, so if you have to have consistency, you might compromise some of the things. So the last category would be the most lesser to provide you the speed, because say when you are trying to purchase the graph storage, what happens is basically you have to build the entire tree in one go and then realign and merge the tree objects. So that processing is a little bit time consuming. So it will provide you a lot of flexibility, but the speed and the performance will be the last one in this category. So okay, so I have a question from Rakesh. So in key value stores, will the update be a delete? Will the update be a delete and insert operation, or it will be addition of another new row? Okay, so that's really a good question. So say for example, if we take a React kind of a storage solution, so it is up to the implementations how do they provide this kind of operations. If some operations feel that deleting and adding a new record is much more faster than updating a particular record, they would choose the implementation. As far as I'm aware of, this is absolutely dependent on the internal design and the architecture of that particular technology, what it does. So what React does is basically React supports the update operations in a key value store where you can go and update the operation, because there are some features in React. It also says you can have secondary indexes and partial updates. So they're all trying to compete with the industry NoSQL offerings. So initially it is understood that add and delete would have been much more faster, but they all tend to provide that update feature with sacrificing that fraction of nanosecond, but it gives a flexibility. So ideally it is an update operation which people would prefer, and that's what people are trying to derive and build it in. Okay, so I have a question from Mihir Daya asking, could you please explain the document database once again? So I have explained the key value store and the big data column family data store. So the key value store, all you could do is using a key, read and update or do a write operation on that particular column store. You cannot do partial reads or writes. Column family, it allows you to do a partial updates using the key, always the key. The key is the handler for your data. So that is the key thing in the first key value store and the column value store. In the document database, the key is still required, but it provides you a flexibility to retrieve the information without providing a key. But when you write a record or update a record, you still need a key. So what it does is basically the only difference in this category is, as I explained, you can have documents and you can have secondary indexes on that document elements or the data inside that document. Say for example, I have storage structure where I'm storing all the persons in a country. Okay, so let's assume person is a table, and in that person table, say I have key as the social security number as the ID, and all the columns like city, state and age as columns. Or in case of documents, in case of MongoDB, let's say that is entire JSON object. So what usually we can do is pick one of these two columns where we would be running indexed queries or ad hoc queries based on the values. So I say, assume I would be running queries on the state and the age. So in this case, what I need to do is go and pick the element state or city and index all my records in that particular data storage so that I can query based on the column like city or state. Instead of passing the keys, I should also have the capability of going and querying the data within that particular elements. So in this case, I say I need to go and fetch all the records or all the people who are in Texas and who is under 2025 age. In this case, I don't need to provide the keys. I can do is basically go and provide the indexed values and fetch all the records who is matching that criteria. So that's a basic difference between a document database and column family database and key value store. So these three have very slight variations. They all have a fuzzy overlap between each other, basically because they all try to compete and provide more or less the similar features. But the variation comes in the non-functional requirements or the non-functional aspects of it. So I hope that gives a lot of insights into what exactly document database is. Moreover, we can also look into some of the examples in the later stage of the course, what exactly we're going to do with the column families and what we can not do with the column family that would give more interesting insights into what a document database is and what you can leverage to use it for. Okay, so we're going to use a particular use case and we're going to do a quick deep dive of what use cases Cassandra would be useful for and why we should use Cassandra and how we can leverage some of these technologies in a real world application. So let's pick, as per our initial conversation, let's pick the same example of I'm trying to go and find a flight and I'm trying to book a flight or a hotel. For this use case, what the e-commerce or travel portals used to do is basically they used to use a decade old or a decade back. They used to have a web application layer and they used to have a traditional RDBMS, which used to host all the normalized data in traditional RDBMSs like Oracle, MySQL, and then fetch all these information, aggregate in SQLs, and then display it on the page. So in our use case, let's assume we have 5,000 users coming on to this particular application, web application, and it is easy as of today, you can e-scale the web application layer, which is just only hosting the application processing. So it is only hosting and doing the web application request processing. So the actual data is still in the databases. So what happens here is, since we are using a traditional RDBMS, since the data is not that decentralized, since it is all located in one or two locations or two nodes, and it is, since it is also normalized into all entities and you have to build the relations to build this table, we may end up making more than few hundreds of queries to the database just to display one full page content. In some cases, I have seen applications which used to make humongous data queries because the data was highly normalized. When the data is highly normalized, you have to use heavy joins and data aggregation to pull all the content and display it in on the user interface or the user web application. So that was the basic problem. So the more and more the data grew, the more and more the transactions grew, the hotspot or the bottleneck started appearing on the database or then the data store layer. So basically what happens is, basically if you translate every transaction into, say, even 300 SQL reads or some few updates, so drastically it's going to put a lot of load on heavy operational criticalness on the data store. So people started scaling that on the RDBMSs, but still they faced a lot of challenges because there is a lot of data which is changing on these RDBMS simultaneously. There are a lot of transactions which is to go and fetch this information. So the next option people thought about is, okay, why don't we avoid humongous reads and to the database? Instead of that, let's try to cache it into the application layer so that we could avoid some of these heavy loads which is going into the database and which is crashing or creating a lot of maintenance issues on the database or the data store layer. So the only challenge with this approach is, basically if you use a caching layer, the challenge becomes is, basically even though if it is a distributed cache kind of a model, the amount of effort you need to make to synchronize, it's, there is no inbuilt tools which can which any RDBMS tools can offer the caching layer for the application. So there were a lot of commercial products and a lot of frameworks or tools like Memcache, Membase came into existence just because of this, just to cache the data. So the challenge with caching is there is a lot of effort and complexities in synchronizing the data in the actual data store and also into the caching layer. So that was a nightmare, and again, it would provide you the speed and flexibility, the syncing becomes a challenge. So the other option is, instead of working with this heavy challenges and nightmare of managing the sync between cache layer and the data store, people started incubating the ideas like Cassandra, so that you can have much more faster data access and you can have humongous data loads with a distributed architecture where you can have very less latencies. So that's where people have started incubating and trying to use solutions like Cassandra to fill some of the rendering aspects in as fast as possible for the list page. Say, for example, on the flight listing or the hotel listing, I don't need to follow on key consistency aspects, but I can also focus on the availability aspects of it. So you can choose some of the technologies like Cassandra and try to work on it. So I have a question from Venkatesh. Basically, what Venkatesh is asking, is it similar to Informatica? Okay, so this is a little bit variant from Informatica, from whatever I have seen. So the Informatica, what people used to use it for, majority of the things was for bulk data processing for any analytical and business decision process. So primarily in the last decade, it was heavily used to do a lot of bulk analytic processing and to make any decision-making process to the business and the technical leadership. So Cassandra is a little bit different, where you can use it for the real-time applications in real-time latency and performance requirements, where everything is happening at real-time, ad hoc reads and writes. So that's a basic difference. So Ashokan R has a question. Whenever we talk about NoSQL, its main advantage is its scalability nature. What the mean in real-time scenario? Why RDBMS is not scalable? Please explain with real-time scenarios if possible. Okay. So for us to just understand this, we need to understand a little bit how the traditional RDBMS has been built and how it provide some of the key features or the flexibility. So we have spoken about the traditional RDBMS focuses on consistency. Consistency is the key requirement for any RDBMS. How RDBMS provides you that flexibility is basically the way it has been architected and the way it has been designed to provide that consistency. In traditional RDBMS, what happens is one block, say even if you have duplicate blocks in your rack environment or in your duplicated data and when your data partition is done, so there is a lot of coordination or syncing which needs to happen. Say if there is a block one which has a row, table row record, and that particular lock goes into a transactional mode, that block has to be locked and it has to go through multiple phases of going into a commit log, having a checkpoint, locking that record, having a save point, and then releasing that lock. So when a client is blocking that particular record, everyone else waits. So basically, traditional RDBMS has a very strong locking mechanism and very strong checking mechanism. So even before it goes and acquires locks, it goes and does a lot of dictionary lookups. Like it goes and sees whether it has the ability to lock that particular object, whether it has to whether it has a particular operation right. So even if you can get a lock, you might not be able to do every operation. So you might be only able to do a select operation. You might be able to do only a delete operation. So all these checkings, all these definitions, there are multiple checks. So it's like you're very strict locking. You start a piece of block of code. It provides all the consistency and synchronization. Once you are done, release that lock. So every other thread which is waiting for that particular block has to wait. So just because of this, there is a lot of syncing and coordination which needs to happen between so we call it, say, in Oracle terminology, we call it inter-rack communication or inter-node communication. So this is way too complex. And since Oracle is built for consistency, the more and more the data grows, the more and more the transaction grows, and everything getting into a transactional locking mode, it spends majority of the time in the internal aspects, what we call it as a thrashing, instead of really serving the client users or the end users. So that's where a traditional RDBMS poses the real challenge, and it cannot scale beyond an extent of few hundreds of terabytes of information just because it cannot handle that distributed data. It is not built to handle that distributed data that well. So it handles very well in a centralized server, and it has been architected and designed to work in the local data where the data is locally residing in one physical location. That's why the RDBMSs cannot scale. And I have a personal experiences whatsoever people call why cannot traditional commercial open source RDBMSs cannot scale. The best example is we run the most powerful machines with Hexadata and solid state disks with just less than 50 terabytes of information, with huge multi-core hexa-core hardware on heavy infrastructure. We still face challenges in lot of hotspots happening on every node when there is a bulk reads and writes happening, and when the data is growing and partition getting out of equation. Indexing is always a challenge. So because the primary data model is a B-tree, and B-tree indexing is deadly against the data partitioning, and it cannot scale. Any B-tree data storage poses huge challenge in scaling the data in distributed fashion. So I think that's a very detailed explanation. Some of the real-time explanation I could give is, if you pick up the hotels application or flights application, the hotels can have possibly a few 30 to 40 billion records for a particular scenario. So I need to know the prices on different dates for the next 365 days. I have experience of storing more than 40 billion records in table, and Oracle cannot store, and Oracle cannot any traditional RDBMSs cannot handle that volume, that scale, whereas NoSQL technologies like Cassandra scales easily, and the only thing is it may not be immediately consistent, but it can be eventually consistent. So that's a basic real world example I could think of. Okay, so I could just quickly jump on to the next use case summary. So basically, say for example, how do I pick and choose what could be the possible use cases for my Cassandra adoption or implementation? So say for example, let's put across some of the high level requirements. Okay, what could be for adaption when these are my requirements. Say for example, I have both B2B and B2C interacting consumers or clients on my storage solution, and I have a very high volume of data transactions happening on my storage, so more than 5 million page hits on a day, which is translating to very high IO and disk access and very random reads and random updates happening. And there are a lot of inventory suppliers who is randomly going and changing in my hotels or in my flight system across the globe. And there is a huge, humongous database inventory in one table. So as I told you, so say, in a hotel's equation, you'll end up having 30 to 40 billion records. Someone would say, hey, that's too high. No, it's not too high. So let's, even if you take the most conservative inventory data set, say with 200 or 500,000 hotels across the world, and every hotel needs to store the prices for the next 3 years, and for different combinations, like if there is one person, this is the price. If two person, this is the price. The hoteliers offer different prices for, say, different length of stays up to 90 days. And if one person stays, this is the price for one person, one night. If two person stays one night, this is the price. If, say, for example, if a child stays, this is the price. So there are humongous combinations which exponentially grows the data size. So if you have something like that sort, you should always try to pick a data store which is completely denormalized, ready to be fetched and ready to be displayed, instead of having completely normalized entity-based databases is not going to scale. That's pretty big challenge from my experience. If you have very high random reads and writes happening, your inventory is always changing. If someone is already booked a hotel, immediately they have to notify you, and you have to block that inventory so that you don't sell that inventory on the page anymore. So there are a lot of volatile and fluctuations in your reads and writes. And say if your application has a demand of it, always has to be available 99.99%. This is the industry standard, so you cannot achieve 100% because there could be some challenges once in a while. So in these kind of scenarios, you cannot afford your data store to even go down for a fraction of a second. So you need to have that high availability of your system, and you need to also have a very secure and rock solid fault tolerance and reliable data store, because you cannot afford, if a node goes down, it takes away some data blocks, it takes away some processing capacity, or it takes away some clients or sessions. So it has to be so rock solid that even something goes wrong with physical machines, it has to support that all the fault tolerance and all the things very transparent and opaque to the client, so it should not disturb anything. If it has to be really fast and you are looking for something elastic scale, we'll talk about what exactly elastic scale is and how we can achieve and how we can do things like adding more servers or infrastructure to the existing clusters. If you have anything which needs to be invented or innovated much more quickly, tried onto the systems, basically, with a traditional RDBMS, is altering the table, going and making the changes in the applications, it's a time-consuming process. The Cassandra kind of a storage family is where it offers flexible wide column families and sparse matrix where you can add columns at runtime, gives you a flexibility to go and try new things at runtime so that the changes are much more faster and you can deliver the applications much more quicker, so that it gives much more time to the market. So it should be also cost effective, and it should be also easily maintainable. When I say easily maintainable, there is a huge difference between any commercial traditional RDBMS maintenance requirements versus something like Cassandra. A traditional RDBMS needs extensive internal architecture knowledge and practical knowledge and years of experience, because maintaining a production grade cluster, configuring it with various options, maintaining, monitoring, is a huge expensive affair in traditional RDBMSs. If your application does not need that kind of infrastructure, it has to be very cost effective, it has to be very low in cost in maintenance and in the infrastructure upgrades, Cassandra could be one of the potential use case. So as we discussed, there are three different approaches. You can achieve all these requirements or all these business needs either the legacy way of pure RDBMS. The only thing is you'll end up facing the challenges as the data and as the transactions grow over the period of time. And you can also choose the augmented way of having RDBMS with caching, and or you can have an option of straight away using Cassandra and scaling it to the big data scale and the big data needs. So basically, these are the three approaches, but we'll be focusing more on how we can use Cassandra and see how we can build applications around it. Okay, so I think I have a question from Jagdish N. So where exactly the Cassandra is primarily used? Is it in OLAP or OLTP? Okay, primarily Cassandra, we use it in majority of the OLTP applications, but there is no restrictions not to be used in the analytical platforms. Basically, Hadoop kind of infrastructures or platforms is much more suitable for OLAP, but Cassandra also offers integration points to your analytical platforms, to like Hadoop and HDFS kind of platforms where you can still go ahead and use it. But primarily, I would recommend to use it in OLTP because that is the primary purpose of using this data storage for real-time applications. But there is no stopping. You could still explore, but there are better solutions available for OLAP than Cassandra. So I would recommend OLTP. Okay, so let's quickly jump on to some of the things what we need to understand when we are trying to learn Cassandra. So basically, Apache Cassandra is derived from the Google and Amazon specifications like Dynamo and GFS. It was initially incubated in Facebook and then contributed towards open source, and then it is being committed by Apache now. It is basically an open source platform built on top of completely on Java. It is a peer-to-peer distributed architecture platform data storage solution, column family database oriented. So when I say peer-to-peer and distributed, so here the data is distributed across all the nodes, and any node can perform a read or a write operation, even though that node which is getting the request may not have the data block. So internally, everything is identical and similar. So you can go and distribute the data. And there are a lot of techniques how the data is distributed and how the data is sharded using the partition and the replication and the snitches techniques. So the data gets distributed. But implicitly, Cassandra takes care of distributing, reading, and writing from this distributed data set. We also call this as a decentralized database. The reason why we call it as decentralized compared to any other technology like master slave, slave technology, in master slave architectures, you have a bottleneck on the masters. So if you take HBase, if you take Hadoop, if you take MongoDB, they are all based and derived out of master slave architecture. So the master becomes the bottleneck here. So the master, if something goes wrong with the master, your anti-cluster goes down. If something goes down with your replica sets in MongoDB, everything goes down. That data is taken away from that. If something goes wrong in the name node or region nodes, that entire thing is taken away. But it's not the case with Cassandra. In Cassandra, it's like a cluster of nodes or physical machine. Everything is identical and everything does the same job as the other node. So in this case, one node or half of the nodes failing will not get your cluster or database down unless you have at least bare minimum or basic number of requests in that cluster which can go and process your request. It's completely decentralized. So it is also elastically scalable. It can scale horizontally as well as you can think of, and also scale elastically very good. We're going to talk about what exactly it is basically. So for now, we'll just focus on it supports the elastic and the horizontal scalability as well as the vertical scale with multiple options as well as anything you could think of. So it also provides you that high availability just because of the architecture and the design, the way it has been provided to interact. It supports that high availability and fault tolerance. So any number of nodes, until you have the bare minimum nodes available, you can still work with it. Any number of nodes going down and coming up will not affect the cluster performance at times, and you will not be seeing any disruption in the client interactions. So there is something which we'll talk about, consistency, eventual consistency, and strong consistency. How do you achieve strong consistency? By tuning the Cassandra configurations or at programmatically or at runtime. So we'll be talking in a very short while from here. And it's, since we already spoke about it, it's a column-oriented database. So that's the features of what Cassandra is all about. So we'll be exploring all these things in details in the upcoming slides in the upcoming modules. So for now, we'll just keep it here. Okay, so for just to make sure we understand the distributed and the decentralized concepts much more clearly, so what I thought of is putting up a quick example of a post office. So what happens in a post office model is basically So let's assume there are three counters, like one is a currency exchange counter, and there is a stationary exchange counter, and say there is a couriers or letters dispatching counter. So there are three consumers or customers who want to interact in a post office. So what the post office model has done is basically everyone comes to post office, and post office has placed a interactor or a help desk who coordinates with all these clients, and then the coordinator or the help desk person redirects them to a different counter based on who is available and what is the purpose of the need. So what happens here is, say, a person coming up and choosing to interact with a counter in currency exchange, the coordinator coordinates and then he gets his job done. Similarly, the person coming for a courier, he gets directed to a letters counter and courier counter. So similarly, for a stationary guy, he would eventually get directed to a stationary counter. So the problem with this model is basically everything is getting redirected or routed through a coordinator, and the coordinator becomes the bottleneck. Say, for example, if coordinator is taking off, or he's taking leave, or he's just going off away for a few minutes to take a call, everyone has to wait because they are not allowed to go and interact directly, because everything has to go through the help desk or coordinator. So in this case, he becomes the bottleneck, and there is a huge waiting time for basically all these consumers to interact with their particular. So instead of that, what if we had a centralized, instead of a centralized database or a post office, we had a decentralized post office? So in this model, so let's assume instead of dedicating each of the person to do only a specific job, we have allocated everyone to do everything. Say all these counters, all these people are identical. Anyone can handle a currency change exchange request, a stationary or a stationary request, or letters or a courier request. In this case, what happens is basically a person, say in some cases everyone is coming to a currency exchange. In the earlier model, only one person will be always loaded, or hotspot being at one counter. We are diluting the hotspot and distributing it across all the nodes. So at any given point of time, everyone is sharing the load of taking the request, and no one is just queuing up at one counter. So the other advantage is basically, say for example, I have removed the coordinator also in between. So now, since everyone does everything, my clients know that they don't need to go and ask a coordinator where should they exactly go, to which counter. Since everything is similar, they directly go to a counter whichever is free. So what helps is that instead of having that huge queue and waiting time, they basically go and interact with every counter and get their job done. The other aspect what the post office has introduced basically is, say for example, I could take any request. And say I have to take a call, emergency call, and I have to step away from my machine or from my workplace. What I could do is, instead of just blindly going away, either I just inform, or my colleagues can keep watching me just in case I was in between something and I left. My colleagues will be watching me, and they will be able to take up my half-done process on behalf of the clients, so that even if I'm stepping away, the clients are not getting disturbed. So that way, my post office has changed the process of removing the centralized bottlenecks and having a similar coordination between all the nodes, and everyone gets their work done much more faster. So that's the concept of, or the that's the way contrast between centralized and decentralized post offices. So we're going to see exactly how this is applicable in Cassandra and see what is the basic difference. So let's, before going there, so let's quickly see, there is a question from Venkatesh. In future, all banking sectors may implement the Cassandra if the data are more than 3 billion rows. Please correct me if I'm wrong. Okay, so yeah, that's a really interesting catch. It may not be required. So there are some techniques like hybrid models. Like in your, say, all finance or critical banking applications, So there will be some portion of the data which needs to be locked, similar to what we have seen it in the e-commerce applications. We cannot just use one solution to get that high availability and high data scale. Say, for example, my majority of the operations, the millions of operations are happening on that denormalized 30 billion data store where I'm not locking those records. There is no transactional need for that particular of processing. So in that case, in that particular use case or the processing use case, I would still use a data store which is not required to be very strongly consistent like Cassandra. And when I eventually go to a booking phase, in that case, what happens is basically I'm not running ad hoc queries on the data structure. Even if I have a partial read just for one record, which is only indexed on one primary key, even though you have 3 billion records or 3 billion rows, it will scale. The reason why it will scale is you are not querying on the columns, or you're not querying or indexing on the data. You are only directly going and locking one particular record, which is only required to just book that particular record. And that is much more easier in B-trees. Locating one particular record and going and locking is much more easier to do it in a traditional RDBMS when you have ad hoc queries where you have to go and fetch multiple records much more faster in a high data store where you have to go and scan multiple indexes, or you have to go and join multiple indexes and get in some cases, even you might end up doing a full table scan. Those are the places I'm recommending to avoid. It's not that you have to always go and use Cassandra. So it's not the case. So the trend or the evolution is people are evolving to a more a hybrid model where there are already places, even in the finance applications, they use a lot of hybrid solutions. Say, for example, if they have huge products or enormous products, these are the places where you don't need transaction to lock that particular record. So all you need is to be much more denormalized or aggregated data store. And then when you go and block a particular record or do a transaction, when it goes to a transfer records, you still need a very strong, consistent data store. So I think I've provided some of the contrasting answers on that. So since we were just talking about distributed, decentralized post office model, so this is the exactly same model what Cassandra adapts, and it is a distributed peer-to-peer architecture where every node in the cluster is identical, not just like in your Hadoop or MongoDB kind of architecture where your masters are designated to do a different job, your job trackers or your data nodes are designated to do something different, your secondary nodes are designated to do something. So it's not a designated nodes, or it's not a designated replica sets or region sets, just like in other platforms like replica sets or region name nodes kind of thing. So everything is similar. Everything, every node does every operation the Cassandra supports. That's the key difference. So let's assume, let's talk about the peer-to-peer interaction. So since the post office, they have implemented watching the other colleagues going out in, coming in so that they can take care, Cassandra does this exactly same of adapting the peer-to-peer protocol and using some gossip protocols to understand the failures around their regions and make sure those data is always consistent and those requests are not sent to those nodes when the nodes are down, and make sure all the data and the communication is in sync. So everything can be taken care internally. So there are no special host or coordinating activities which Cassandra consumer or application developer needs to worry about. So everything is built in so that all you need to do is just talk to a cluster, just read the information and write the information back. The coordinating, the syncing, the replication, the partition strategies, and all the repair strategies, everything is inbuiltly taken care of with some configuration capabilities which you can fine-tune it to a way that what is suitable for your application. Okay, so since it adapts a peer-to-peer protocol and uses a gossip protocol, and every node is identical as long as it has minimum number of nodes or servers to serve the request, there is no single point of failure. So any node can fail. So in your contrasting with Hadoop or MongoDB, if your name node fails, your entire cluster goes down. So in this case with Cassandra, any node can go down. So basically it can still support all the client requests without disrupting the operational process of the cluster. The one good thing I have personally seen, it's easier to operate and maintain because all nodes are same and identical. So just in case of any other contrasting master-slave technologies, it is very critical for you to have a huge critical focus on, say, master nodes or on the job tracker nodes where the jobs are being tracked or the master regions of it. So instead of having that model, if you have everything identical, it becomes much more easier to scale and it is much more easier to maintain since all nodes are similar and every node does the same thing. You need not to worry about to pay special attention or special infrastructure needs on different nodes. Okay. So we have a question from Ashish Pandey. So what Ashish's question is, what is white column? So basically a white column is nothing but the amount of columns what you can store. So something like, say for example, if you have say millions of columns, at runtime it should like shrink and grow based on your requirement. So in a traditional RDBMS, it's not recommended to have millions of rows. So you will be restricted to have few, say not more than say 10 to 20 columns. That's max, and that's to treat it as a worst denormalized data structure in traditional RDBMS. But it is encouraged in NoSQL, in Cassandra, to have wide column families because it allows you to flexibly query and add columns at runtime. So you can go even up to few billions of columns at runtime, and you can also purge automatically all these columns by setting the time to live kind of model. So that's basically having humongous columns is something treated as a white column family, a white column, as simple as that. How do we write data? I mean, do we have to write DNS entry for all nodes? Okay, this question is basically from Manish Kumar. Okay, so this is a really good question, interesting. So this is what happens. So since every node is identical, you have multiple options. You don't need to worry about managing the name servers or mapping those entries or the server IPs into a DNS entry and then routing all the data packets through a DNS lookup kind of a thing. You could do that. There is nothing wrong in doing it, but all the simplest way is basically pick all the IP names and provide all the IP names to your client. So there are multiple flavors or multiple implementations of how you can interact with Cassandra. So basically the best model is to have your client figure out the load balancing strategies just by looking into the IPs. There are a lot of implementations just by, even Oracle does that. So if you have worked with a lot of Oracle, JDBC, Oracle, the client-side load balancing before service names or the scan names in Oracle. So you can just give all the node names in client and say, this is my nodes and this is my IPs and this is my port and this is my listener. These are all the nodes what I can do operations. The client figures out all the load balancing techniques. So you don't need any DNS entries. The other way of doing it is basically, okay, the DNS only comes into picture when you need a host name and you have to interact only with a host name. It's not absolutely required to host name. It's an unnecessary operation to have a lookup for that host name in a DNS entry. So please avoid doing that. The other way of doing it is having a virtual IP assigned to a load balancer, and the load balancer figures out the scheduling or the routing mechanism of the request coming in from the clients. That is again unnecessary, and avoid doing that, because I've seen people doing all these sorts of things where they assign a virtual IP on a load balancer and use that virtual IP on the cluster. The only advantage of doing that is basically you might have a better maintenance and tracking aspects of your load balancing request. You can change the load balancing strategies at runtime from round robin to say different data center, all those things. But the clients nowadays are smart enough to do all these kind of things, so please even avoid doing that. So the best thing is to do a client-side load balancing by providing all the IPs and just the port name, that port number. That's a straightforward thing. Okay, so I have another question from Ashokan R. Billions of records or billions of columns? So there are two things. Technically, there is some limitations of the number of columns you can have in Cassandra, but you can go up to 2 billion records till Apache Cassandra 1.2. And after that, I think there are a lot of enhancements and there is no restrictions as of now. I haven't really tried and tested what is the maximum extent you could go up to, but 2 billion is really good enough columns for any table. The records, I have tried up to 30 to 40 billion records in a data store, so in a particular table. So there is technically no limitations, but we haven't seen any challenges or issues in handling the number of records, because the more and more the records you add, it consumes more and more data storage, and you need to add more, you have to throw more hardware and more you have to do more horizontal scaling to handle more number of billions of records. So technically speaking, there is a key ranges where every node handles, and the more and more hardware you keep scaling in horizontal, those key ranges are assigned to one physical machine or virtual machine or a virtual node where they handle only that particular range set between the records. So even if you have billions of records, trillions of records, when it comes to Cassandra, Cassandra only works with that limited range of records or keys. So in that way, it doesn't have any issues in scaling infinitely, but we don't know exactly what is the limitation when exactly any one of these key space solutions can start failing. Okay, technically, there is some restrictions on the number of nodes based on the subnet masks. You cannot go more than maybe around 255 subnets, so that is exponential number of requests, so let's not worry too much on that, so we could go n number of. Okay, I have a question from Jagdish N. If all the nodes are same, then who will manage the nodes? Do we have name node and data node concept in Cassandra? Okay, so there is no name node or there is no data node concept in Cassandra. So I know you're trying to refer it to Hadoop. So Hadoop is a master-slave architecture. So all your master nodes are like your name node and your secondary name node, and all your slave nodes has the data node, the data daemon, and the job tracker nodes, which is part of your slave node. So there is nothing called anything of this sort, because it is completely different. It is not a master-slave architecture. It is a peer-to-peer distributed architecture, and every node is identical. So every node does every operation what Cassandra supports. It's not a designated node, does only a few things. So in that way, we don't have anything which is anything similar to name node or a data node, but it is totally different with everything doing everything. Okay, so let's quickly resume with where we have left with our conversation. So we were talking about the elastic scalability. So before getting into the elastic scalability, we can talk about the horizontal scalability and the vertical scalability. Say, for example, when you have requirements of handling huge data volumes, so the traditional RDBMS is the trend or the ideal practice is to do a vertical scaling, because your data has to be located locally and it has to be located in concrete and one location as much as possible. So for that one primary reason, the traditional RDBMSs or the traditional centralized systems try to grow their power by scaling it horizontally. When I mean vertical scaling, basically they add more and more, say, CPU resources, they add more and more memory resources, they add more and more data storage to those machines so that they can handle more number of requests and more number of data. But there is a challenge with it. There is a limitation to what extent you can scale vertically. You cannot scale vertically to an extent where horizontal scalability can go up to infinite as long as you have the flexibility of investing into horizontal infrastructure. Because you cannot have infinite CPUs in one machine, physical machine. You cannot have one infinite memory slots in one machine. You cannot have infinite SCSI or data controllers or data blocks or hard disk controllers or SSD slots in one machine. There is a physical limitation and upper limit. So you cannot scale vertically after a certain point or after an extent, but you can definitely scale horizontally. So all the cloud implementations or there are all the examples or the derivations of horizontal scale. So you can do horizontal scale with commodity hardware, and you can do n number of node additions, and it can scale horizontally as much as you can want. So that's a basic difference between what horizontal and vertical scale is. When we come to elastic scale, Cassandra supports the horizontal and elastic scale very well. Well, what I meant was, since every node is identical, basically all you can do is add more and more of nodes when you have demand and remove those nodes out when you don't have a demand. So that's what basically elastic scalability is all about. Okay, so Cassandra supports these things without even a glitch. So when you have huge fluctuating requirements happening, you can add few nodes into the cluster and you can join them to the cluster, and without even disrupting all the client processes, you can support and do all these operations. Okay, so I have a question from Manish Kumar, where the question is there any challenges maintaining indexes for billions of data? Yes, B-tree indexes are good enough if you have horizontal or width. It is not good when it is having huge depth. So when I mean B-tree indexes, all your traditional RDBMSs uses B-tree index data store or the data structure. So that's how it mutually decides which node to jump and what data to be fetched. So the more and more the data depth and the data width grows in the B-tree indexes, it is really, really horrible to manage and scan. So it is of no use. The more number of jumps you have to make, the more number of decisions you have to make, there is no point in storing all these things in indexes. There are different techniques and different ways of handling these things. So instead of handling everything it in a B-tree index, there can be lookups, map lookups, and multiple stages of lookups where you have to figure out where my data partitions can go. Instead of going and figuring that every time, you do it while writing. So that's what Cassandra does. So Cassandra uses the intelligent techniques, which we'll be focusing on in the future slides or in the future modules, where it decides where exactly the data should go. Instead of deciding it at the runtime while reading, it decides where this data should go at the runtime by assigning something called tokens for one partition and tokens for another partition and every partition range. So while reading the data, it knows which physical node or which virtual node that particular partition or the token ranges is located so that it directly goes there. So it is something like reversing the concept. You're going and figuring out by indexing the data at runtime. You reverse the concept of doing it at the right time, and then you go and directly fetch that information. So managing indexes for billions of records, yes, it is a problem if you have a huge depth and width in your B-tree. So avoid doing that. So just to quickly trying to connect the dots between the post office model and the Cassandra data architecture, how exactly it helps. So we have seen in our post office model where we had the flexibility of distributed, decentralized concept. But just extending it to the elastic scalability, since now everything, every counter is similar, any consumer or any customer can go to any counter. All I need is, say, for example, there is a huge demand for any seasonality that I need to buy a lot of stationery for or couriers for on particular season. All I need to do is hire some contractors and just club them together. And once the seasonality or the period is over, I can just take away that particular counter so that I can go back to my normal operation. So that is what elastic scalabilities, and this is something similar to Cassandra. The cluster must accept new nodes without any, not even major disruption, without any minor disruptions or reconfiguration efforts. It should be all it should all happen at runtime without even me going and changing the cluster, stopping it, restarting it, changing my code, kind of things. The process should not be restarted. Yes, exactly. You will not be able to do any restarts or not required to do any restarts if the nodes are coming and going down. As I said, the only advantage I mentioned in one of the questions was if you use a virtual IP, you don't need to reconfigure your client. You can directly go and work with a virtual IP. So that's the advantage with the virtual IP load balancing model. So if you're using that, you don't need to change anything, the application, as the cluster is changing. So you don't need to worry about how to rebalance, how to assign the load, how to reshuffle the load. Everything is inbuilt. Everything takes care internally. So you don't need to worry about the routing, rebalancing, load balancing kind of approaches. Just add a node and just move on. And once you're done, just take it away. So because of this kind of a process and this kind of a model, it supports a very high available, no downtime kind of platform where you can keep working even if one node goes down, and if he or the other counter comes back, your account will be, your cluster will be still active and it will be servicing all the consumers or clients. So that's pretty... Okay, I have a question from Sushil Nakur. Cassandra is P2P, peer-to-peer architecture. What's the advantage of this architecture when we process the data? Does it process in all the nodes since they are all identical? Okay, that's really good question, Sushil. So what it means for peer-to-peer architecture is it says everything is identical and everything can be processed by any node. Okay, so that's the basic definition of it. So technically what happens is any node can do only two things, either read or write operation. So when you send a read request for a node, that node is called as a coordinator node. So the coordinator node, now it is the responsibility of that node to make sure the read or the write operation succeeds. So depending on your replication and partition strategies, the coordinator node will decide or it will figure out where exactly these data blocks are existing based on the token partitioning and token replacement, token placement strategies. Say if your replication factor is 3 and the coordinator knows based on the token, key tokens, where exactly this data has been replicated and located. So it will send the read request to all the three nodes. So 1, 2, and 3. So it will wait for some of the nodes or all of the nodes to respond based on the replication and the consistency levels you have configured. So if the consistency level is very loose, by default it is say 1, so the moment it gets back one request from one node response, it will respond to the client and say your operation has been succeeded. So technically speaking, it is not that all the nodes will be doing all the operations, but there are some background operations where there will be minimum number of same tasks will be executed on the some of the nodes based on the replication and the partition strategies. So it will not be all the nodes, but there will be some duplication happens in the Cassandra inter-process communication. So that's what it is. Okay, so let's resume from where we have left. So let's talk about what exactly is tunable consistency and what is eventual consistency and strong consistency. How do we achieve it? So Cassandra offers basically out of the box the basic consistency model called eventual consistency. So what eventual consistency says is basically it says your data will be consistent eventually, not immediately. So what it means is basically if you do a write operation, since the data is replicated and since the data will have duplicates and any request can go to any node, so there will be a lag between these replication depending on your replication factor. So possibly there could be a fraction of nano or millisecond latencies when it eventually becomes consistent. So if you are trying to read, write and read the same data within the same time frame within next fraction of nanosecond, it is possible to have duplicate data in your reads when you read that particular data element. The chances of that happening in my experience is just less than 1%, because there is some techniques which Cassandra offers. Even with the eventual consistency, it checks the timestamps, the 64-bit machine timestamps before returning the data. Whichever is the recent data, that is the only one is returned, and it discards the other data and corrects that the data which is having that old one. So Cassandra offers eventually consistency by using three primary techniques like the read repairs, the anti-entropy, and the node repair tool. So basically they are some of the concepts which we'll be getting into the details when we get there. We'll be discussing in detail. So just before seeing what a strong consistency and how we can tune for the strong consistency, there is a question from Venkatesh. Who is using Cassandra more in the market and what is the scope of Cassandra? Okay, so it's a very interesting question. So basically anyone can use Cassandra, and whoever has the use cases or the requirements which we went through, like high volatile read write kind of requirements where you have to have a peer-to-peer high availability and partition needs, can use it. Who exactly is using it? Say for example, this was built, incubated and derived by Facebook. So Facebook had that huge volume of data processing and data reads and writes happening at ad hoc fashion. So they were the one who were the earlier adapters who introduced this to Apache community, and further they have a lot of hundreds of implementations. So there are majority of the e-commerce domain and travel sector with e-commerce use cases where the majority of them needs the speed, and there is a lot of volume of the data. So there is a lot of reference implementation, like Amazon for all that matter. They use Cassandra for quick and fast displaying the results on their listing pages. There are a lot of travel portals like Expedia. I don't want to name all the portals or all the OTAs, there are a lot of use cases where there is high available requirement and data distribution requirement. People go ahead and use that. Okay, I have another question basically from Ashish Pandey. Okay, what means it depends on coordinator? What happens if coordinator fails? Okay, say for example, when you got a request to a node, it behaves like a coordinator. It doesn't mean that there is something called a node coordinator. Every node plays a role of a coordinator. So what happens is basically, say after getting the request, say the coordinator fails before responding to the client. So the client sends, since there are multiple nodes and every node is equivalent, so the client sends another request. If the first request did not respond in the equal time, the client sends another request to a different node and marks that node which did not respond in the timeout setting, whatever the agreed to timeout value, and it stops sending to that particular node for a tryout period. So once it figures out that a particular node, a coordinator or a node did not respond, it stops sending and it sends another request. So that way your cluster is not failing for that request. You are assured that you will always get the response back. Okay, so let's see how do we achieve the strong consistency. So basically what happens is with Cassandra, you can eventually get to consistent levels, but there might be some use cases where you can tune it to have a strong consistency. So you can have strong consistency in two ways. One is while you have read consistency versus the write consistency. What it means is basically, say for example, if you have huge volumes of writes and lesser volumes of reads, in that case you should choose for tuning it to a strong read consistency. What happens here is basically you are setting programmatically or configuratively telling Cassandra that when I'm reading the data, make sure depending on my replication factor, every node responds. So my replication factor is say 3 in a 10 node cluster. So what it means is basically when I do a read operation, the coordinator makes sure all the nodes respond before acknowledge the client what is the data. So what happens with this is basically, so coordinator sends the request to all the 3 nodes where the data is located. It fetches back all the 3 nodes with the data and verifies the timestamp. Whichever the data has the highest timestamp returns that data, and if for whatever reason whichever node responded with lower timestamp data, it fixes that data and repairs that node with that data. So that way it achieves the strong consistency while reads. So the similar operation is applied at the write operation if your writes are lower and reads are higher. So you can tune eventually Cassandra to have that strong consistency model by choosing what exactly your use case and how exactly you're going to do that. Okay, I have another question from Ashok. Basically, what he is asking, most of the BFSI domain clients using mainframes for their applications. Is there any use case probability of migrating of mainframe data to Cassandra as it supports OLTP? Okay. This is really critical because we have been working with mainframe systems for last more than 3 decades, and there are a lot of terminal clients in our mainframes where we did not still migrate. So the reason why we couldn't migrate is basically we couldn't even afford getting our system data down for even a fraction of a second, or even for just for a minute. We couldn't get that down and make that switch changeover so that the application stops interacting with the mainframes and it starts interacting with the modern day multi-layered, multi-architected data solutions or applications. That's one of the key things. The other key things, what basically poses challenge with migrating the data from mainframes to Cassandra-based storage solutions is you have to have some sort of mapping between the normalized and the denormalized data. Cassandra works completely on the aggregated data model, where we will be focusing on querying the denormalized data in mainframes. You might have stored a lot of normalized data content, and you need to have some sort of a mapping, and you need to build tools which can be migrated and imported into Cassandra. Technically, yes, but it is a huge challenge, and it needs a lot of architectural modeling and some level of downtime and some level of application tuning on all the clients who is consuming it. So that's a real challenge, and it's not that easy for me, at least. Do you have any name of investment banks, financial institutions who uses Cassandra? I may not have the exact names at this point of time. Maybe I can figure that out offline and share with you guys. But technically, if I'm not wrong, they can potentially use all these technologies to build huge repository of their products, their offerings, and try to use it in a much more efficient storage solutions compared to a database where you don't need that kind of storage, complex data models to just support some sort of listing kind of use case. I have a next question from Manish Kumar. Say we have 10 nodes, 1 to 10 with replication factor 3. Data is distributed over 3 nodes respectively, and then I add an update on node 3 and other nodes are being updated. What data will read from node 8, latest one or random one? Yeah, so that's a really good question. So what happens is, it again, depending on the read, the replication factor, when you send a read request to any node, say node 8, what node 8 does is it knows where the data is stored. Since the replication factor is 3, maybe the data is stored in say 6 nodes, 7 and say 1, 3 nodes. So it sends requests to all these 3 nodes, 6, 7 and 1. So it waits, depending on the consistency levels we have chosen, it waits to either to all the nodes to respond with the data, or depending on say, Okay. I have chosen a consistency level of say 1. So in this case, since the consistency levels I have chosen 1 is very low, whatever the node responds first, it will go and respond the client with that data. And this could be a stale data too. Say if I have chosen a strong consistency level at time of read, so it waits until all the 3 nodes respond and picks up whatever the data has the highest timestamp in the time series and returns that data. For whatever reason, if one node comes back with a stale response, it goes and fixes that particular node and gets the eventual consistency. So that's how it works. Okay. So Cassandra provides the high availability and high performance throughput just by leveraging the architecture and the advantage of multi-core, multi-processor machines. And it can be deployed in multi-data centers, multi-regions. It can go in either in cloud or in multiple racks, in multiple combinations. Since it doesn't have any specific recommendations or dedicated tasks, you can have commodity hardware to cloud infrastructure to any high performing machines. So everything can be mixed and matched. So there is no strong requirement of having one particular or the other. So it scales very consistently and seamlessly. From my personal experience, we have been using multiple implementations on multiple applications. Even we integrate with Google uses our services, and we have terabytes of information stored, and we the Google interacts with more than few hundreds of transactions per second. So we publish updates, everything using Cassandra. We have been running this cluster for last 3 years. Majority of the search engines, the TripAdvisors, Expedias of the world, they all interact. It's a huge multi-scale application. We haven't restarted this cluster for the last 3 years, and everything is running as smooth as we could thought of. And while in contrast, we have a huge deployments of traditional Oracle and MySQL clusters, we always used to have some sort of challenges and some sort of bottlenecks and hotspots in these racks. So that's a kind of experience what I would like to share with you all, you guys. So it's not always one or the other. So based on the use case, one scales better than the other. Okay, so it also has a very fast throughput, high volume of throughput, and basically we do a lot of more than 10,000 writes per second on our clusters, where we couldn't do the same thing on our traditional RDBMSs because they all have a lot of challenges. We do more than 10,000 writes per second parallelly, more than few thousands or 50,000s of reads happening on this cluster, so it operates without even a glitch. So that's the power of the NoSQL Cassandra, what we are working on using it. So where exactly do you use and where to use Cassandra? So don't use Cassandra, say if you have very few records and you don't have vision or data growth which can go into big data kind of a volume. So use if you have billions of records and huge requirement of column store families where you have to flexibly add few hundreds of millions of columns. If your reads and writes are random, so use Cassandra. If you don't know the patterns, it can fluctuate between reads and writes. And if you have a need of a flexible or sparse matrix, so what happens in your traditional RDBMSs is basically if you add a row, the row blocks certain amount of storage space in your data storage. So Cassandra is not like exactly like your traditional RDBMSs. We'll be talking in detail in the data model and in the architecture. So it can store flexible sparse matrices and have when you have a very wide column family. Also, you can use it when you have only limited set of index needs. So do not use this when you have a huge number of multiple secondary indexes and when you have requirements where your data store has to respond as quickly as possible with very low latencies. So we have seen a latency of 10 to 25 milliseconds for bulk operation of 1,000 key reads with 1,000 operations happening simultaneously, more than a few thousand operations happening. So that's the kind of scale it can go up to. And you can use it for different use cases with e-commerce, inventory caches, and you can have it a time series of data or event series of data. So when I say time series, say in flights or hotels, so the amount of inventory window prices is always shifting. So once you are done with that window, all the data which is passed, you don't need that data, and you should have that data automatically purged, and you need some sort of a control where you can generate time series of columns at runtime. So those are the practical examples of where you can use this kind of storage solution. And also if there are any feed based kind of activities, there are a lot of feeds going on, and there are a lot of feeds which needs to be generated from a particular storage with a lot of writes which needs to be augmented. That's where it can help. We have used in very successfully in these use cases. What I would recommend is not to use Cassandra if you have secondary indexes. Just we were talking about how a document storage solutions provide flexibility by adding secondary indexes, and you can query without knowing the keys. So that is all done by providing secondary B-tree indexes so that you can query that objects. If you have a requirement of secondary indexes, you should not use Cassandra at all. That's my personal experience. And if you have a lot of relational data, or if you have a lot of transactionalness in your processing, like rollback, commit, checkpoint, or save points, or if it is very critical to your finance or primary applications, your primary finance or OLTP applications, I would not recommend to use Cassandra. And if you have any stringent security and authorization needs on data, you should still use your traditional RDBMSs, where you have authentication and authorization capabilities at the object and operation level. Say, for example, in say traditional RDBMSs, you can grant operations access at the operational level, at the query level. Different queries can be accessed by different users, different objects can be accessed by different users, and you have control at very granular level. So even though Cassandra offers security and authorization and authentication, it is not to the extent of what a traditional RDBMS does. So please do not use in these cases. So say if you have dynamic query needs. So Cassandra works well if your queries are fixed. When we say if you know what exactly you are querying at runtime, Cassandra works well. So we'll be working in detail in the coming workshops what exactly the dynamic query versus static queries are and how efficient Cassandra is. So if you have anything similar, dynamic query, where I need to query, so the classic example I gave, like based on the value of the document or based on the value of column family, I need to filter something out, I need to group something out, those are all the dynamic query kind of things. It doesn't work that well, so please avoid using it. And also searching on the column data, like doing it like operations or bit vector operations, it's not recommended to use. So that's pretty much, I would say, you should be taking care when you should not use Cassandra. So what we have done is basically we have built a quick small demo application. So we will going through very small quick examples and see how exactly it is done and what it does. So before that, let's see if we have any questions. Okay. Okay, so I have a question from Mihir. So I believe the only difference between HBase and Cassandra is the CAP theorem approach, correct? Because both follows NoSQL and column family concepts. Okay, you are, yes, partially correct, but there are a few more variations to it. So let me just give you some variations or the differences what it has. So basically, HBase and Cassandra, one of the key things is the consistency. So you might take it for assumption that HBase might have a better consistency model versus Cassandra based on the CAP theorem. Apart from that, there is another basic difference. So HBase is not guaranteed to have the amount of availability and the fault tolerance capabilities what Cassandra can offer. So HBase is basically built on top of Hadoop, so it is a master-slave architecture. Still, it will have the same restrictions on the name node or the name node regions, failures if it happens. Cassandra is not that way, so it is much more flexible and robust in fault tolerance, and it can handle a lot of machines going down and coming up. So that's not the case with HBase. So that's the second difference. The third difference is basically, even though both of them are NoSQL style of data storage solutions, both of them are column families. Primarily, I would recommend HBase. Say, for example, even before talking about the recommendation, you need to understand what exactly HBase does. So HBase is derived on top of Hadoop and HDFS file system, and using MapReduce jobs, it generates the data to be written on a HDFS file system. So it works well when you have humongous bulks of information to be submitted in one go. So say you have multiple log files or multiple zip files which you need to, say, few terabytes of zip files which you need to process and store it in a table based on some filtration. Cassandra is not that kind. So Cassandra is not built for huge zip file multi-terabyte information request submissions at one time. It's a record level. It's like a Oracle one key, one row kind of a read request updates. Even though Oracle or traditional RDBMSs are good in handling glob or blob objects, big data objects, but it is not recommended and not built for that. Similarly, Cassandra is not built for storing big data chunks or the big data processing, which HBase does it much more differently and then stores it into a column family. So that's the primary difference. They are all built for different things. So when it comes to HBase, in HBase you have to wait for your MapReduce to finish the job and then populate the records into the table. Cassandra is totally opposite. Cassandra immediately takes up the request within a fraction of nanosecond. It replicates all the data and your data is ready. So say, for example, HBase I could think of more suitable for OLAP and some near OLTP applications once the OLAP is finished. So Cassandra is more suitable for OLTP and less suitable for OLAP kind of. So there are basic differences. There are some differences what HBase versus Cassandra can do, but technically they are column families. Once the data is written, I wouldn't shy away if you are keep on updating the same record. I would not use HBase, because if you are consistently keep on updating the same record, Cassandra scales well, HBase does not scale well. Okay, I have another question from Manish Kumar. We strictly cannot use where clause like thing in Cassandra. Technically, no, we can use where clauses by using secondary indexes, but it is not recommended. That's what I was been referring to. So there is secondary indexes. You can use secondary indexes. Say, for example, if you have very lightweight secondary indexes, say, for example, I'm storing all the keys and I have unique keys with very small data set, I can map it to, say, for example, all the people only in, say, one state. You can still use that where condition or clause in Cassandra, but it is recommended to avoid using that. There are different ways to do that in Cassandra. Instead of using Cassandra where clause, Cassandra is to build for querying and updating the queries. So instead of doing that, build another column family where you will have all the records in one column family which is having like state, say, Texas. So build and populate the data based on your queries. Cassandra is much more faster in doing that. So that's how we can achieve better speed and scalability using Cassandra, not the way putting the conditions into the where clause and adding secondary indexes. Okay, I have another question from Chandrasekhar. Cassandra also integrated Hadoop, right? The core implementation does not offer any Hadoop integration, but there are a lot of open source integration tools which you can put the Hadoop integration or the Hadoop MapReduce jobs onto a Cassandra cluster and work the map or generate the map reduce jobs. So technically it is possible, but it is not part of the core implementation. So it is possible for us to leverage HDFS as well as Hadoop of MapReduce jobs into Cassandra. Okay, I have another question from Sushil. Okay, even before that, I have another question from Manish Kumar. So I think that was a previous question, follow-up question, how strictly we cannot use where clause. So as I already explained, Manish, so you can do this in multiple ways. Technically, you can still use where clause by using secondary indexes. Second way, the best way is not to use a where clause and secondary indexes. Instead of that, have super column families. These are the concepts which will be really interesting when we go to the data models. And using the super column family techniques, you use one more column family on top of the existing, say, people table, and store all the super column keys which you require to access that particular records. So those are the techniques which we'll be discussing in the upcoming modules. So those are the techniques we have to use it instead of using that secondary index and the where clause. Those are the bad practices, or I would recommend it to avoid it. So I have a next question from Sushil. You mentioned Cassandra is used for OLTP data, but on slide 32 it is says Cassandra is not recommended to use when the application has transactional data. Yeah, that's really a good, interesting question. So when we say OLTP, it's a very broad definition or a broad categorization of applications. When we say online transactional processing, we use it very sparingly or in a very loose term. We group some applications or some categories of applications and we say this is OLTP application, say e-commerce, or we treat the entire application as OLTP. But when I was referring to transaction, it was much more granular and it was at the block level. So when I said transaction, I meant, okay, you have to block that particular record for any reads or updates. So that's a basic difference. That's the context what I have used when it comes to OLTP. It is we have treated that as an entire application or a group of use cases as one application. But when it comes to transaction, it was a very specific narrowed down locking of a particular record kind of a scenario. I have another question from Ashish Pandey asking, does Cassandra best suited for unstructured data like files, image, audio, and video? Okay, this is another really good question. Cassandra works well, it scales well when there is structured and semi-structured data. It can store binary format of data, provided the binary size of the data is not so huge. And I wouldn't personally recommend the type of the data what you're recommending, image, audio, and video. So there are much more better solutions like CDN and edge networks or edge servers, which can handle all these solutions much more better, and it can deliver much more faster than your Cassandra. What I would recommend Cassandra to be used is to store the metadata of these information, like what is the URL of the image, where exactly the audio is located, what is the URL of the video. Store these information into Cassandra and use this information to deliver this content from something like a CDN or an edge network. So that is the model what usually people use. So if the question is if I can use Cassandra, yes and no, you can use it for storing the metadata but not the actual data. It does not scale that well, or it is not recommended to use it because... Okay, so let's quickly jump on to, since we have few more minutes, we can spend time on the quick application demo. and we can have a few more Q&A at the end. So basically, I just wanted to give a quick overview. What were the configurations or the parameters, the cluster configuration, replication, partition, snitches, whatever we have been talking about, everything can be done using a configuration file in Cassandra called cassandra.yaml. And also it provides a lot of basic inbuilt tools like to start the servers, to manage the servers, to merge the servers, to repair the servers, and interact with the servers. So we'll not go in details of all these tools. We'll pick only one tool, a couple of tools at this point of time, start a cluster and interact with a cluster using a client tool and see what and all we can do very basic operations. Okay, so I have got a sample application. Basically, what I have done is basically I have built an application on okay, Java client for the same sample application which we have seen it a while back. So when we were trying to discuss about my dating need with flight or hotel booking application, so we went and saw the application need was to have very high availability and data scale requirements where it can store huge requirements. So let's assume I have went and decided to use Cassandra for hotels or flights booking. So let's assume in this case I have decided to use Cassandra for displaying all the hotel rates on a given dates. So that is my key requirement. So what we can do is basically we can have a cluster, and the first thing is to basically connect to a cluster and then create a database. Database is something equivalent in Cassandra is what we call it as a key space. So in traditional RDBMSs, it is called a database, which is a collection or a group of objects and their privileges in a particular schema. So in Cassandra, key space is the namespace grouping similar to traditional RDBMSs. You can group multiple column families and its meta information and its index information into one key space so that you can work with multiple key spaces without having any namespace collisions or without having any conflicts on the column families and its data model. So that's the basic thing. What you need to do is connect to a cluster, create a key space and create a column family before you populate the data. So this application focuses on Java syntax. So don't worry, even if you are not aware of Java, so it's not required that you need to know Java. There are a lot of other mechanisms without Java. You can do it with C sharp. You could do it with any modern day programming language which you are comfortable with. You can go and write applications. So I have picked up Java as this because this is one of the most adapted API in Java Hector. So I have a simple example where I'm in the first place I'm connecting to a cluster basically by providing its IP. Its IP address or the host name with a port 9160, which is the default port for connecting to a Cassandra cluster. If you have more than one node, as I mentioned, you can always choose or adapt the client-side load balancing. You can provide multiple IPs. Your client libraries or implementations are smart enough to do a very efficient load balancing on client-side, and it can connect and it can get you all the required access to do any DDL or DML operation. So basically we are doing two DDL operation. One is creating a key space with very basic meta information. There is a lot of meta information you can provide. We are using a very basic database creation. We're calling that as a hotel key space one, and we also parallelly we are creating a column family called prices in that hotel key space one. So once we create the new key space and the column family, we are just releasing the connection. So this is the bare minimum what you would need when you can, we have to work with Cassandra. You have to go and generate couple of DDL operations. So it's not necessary that you have to do it here. You can do it in the command line clients using SQL or Thrift. So there are majorly two interfaces. Majority of the implementations have been using Thrift, which is a RPC protocol, which uses remote procedure call invocations, where compared to SQL, it is a binary protocol between the client and server. So still, SQL is not that mature and widely accepted. There are a lot of 99% of the adoptions were on based on Thrift API. So I would recommend you all to go and use that. So just quickly, I wanted to go and show you the same example which we have been talking about. So here, I'm making sure. The first thing, I just wanted to demonstrate a tool where I can go and start the start and shut down the Cassandra cluster. So that's what we are talking about. So there are a lot of inbuilt tools. If you have installed Cassandra, go to the bin directory. The first thing you can do is start Cassandra in a synchronous or asynchronous mode, which is more of a foreground or background mode. I've started it in the foreground so that the command window stays for any interactions or any display which comes out of it. And then I could just go and use the Cassandra client tool for interacting with my cluster. So there are a lot of commands which you can go, and we'll definitely explore it over the period of next few sessions. The first thing usually you can do is just going and connecting. By default it connects, but we will still use it for the sake of exercising. Okay, so it says it is connected. So I said connect to localhost 9160 port. This is something, this tool is something similar to your SQL Plus or Toad or any RDBMS client, which you can interact with the database to do any DDL or DML operations. So the first thing I'm going to do is basically go and create some key space and column family. By doing it, I will be able to just go and check whether those key space or column families are created or not. So the first thing is, basically, I'm just running this first example. As we have seen, it says success. So let me just go and see whether the key space is created or not. So the one thing I could use is a command called describe to check whether the hotel key space is being created or not. So if you see, the key space or the database has been created. It is showing what and all column families it has. What is the replication factor? By default, I only have one node because it's been only installed on one. So by default, the replication factor becomes one. And then you can see all the meta information about the prices column family, which we have created while creating the first database. There are a lot of default things. We'll be getting into all these caching, keys only, all these meta information. How do we define it in DDL over the next few classes? So for now, we will just focus on seeing how quickly we can interact with the Cassandra. So that's pretty basic. So once you have connected and you have created a key space and column family, say let's assume now I need to, I need to just go and populate some data. So what I have done is I have picked up the same example of the hotels. So I've picked up the same example of the hotels, and once we are connected and created the hotels and hotel key space and the prices table or the column family, what I'm trying to do is basically trying to generate some data randomly and store the hotel prices for the time-based series. So basically what I'm doing is I'm going and creating for 100 properties, I'm going and creating for the next 365 days, I'm creating the prices randomly. So what happens here is I'm creating the columns at runtime dynamically. So every date is a column, and the value that column is the price. That is the data model, as simple as that. So maybe we can just go ahead and pick much more complex scenarios. For now, the key is the hotel ID. The columns could be the dates, and the value of those columns could be the prices, as simple as that. So what I've done is go and generate these values and see, say, for example, if I can generate the values and store those values. So I have just successfully generated all the values, and then I can go ahead and use the same client to just go and provide the basic data retrieval part, either using the client or using the code. So for checking, I'm using the client. So I need to execute a small command just before reading, because I have not provided anything. So we'll get into the details of what this command is basically. Okay, so we'll be getting into some of these details of exactly what the commands are there. For now, all I am trying to do is I'm saying use this key space, and then I'm saying this is the comparator, because Cassandra works very strictly with the type of the data, what it is trying to query or retrieve. So I need to provide okay, so once I have set some of the basic information, you can do this either at command line or at programmatic level while you're trying to retrieve the data what we have populated. Now I'm trying to read the information what I have populated. So let's say I need the hotel price for, say, property 10. So, okay, does it have prices B10? Okay, so let me just run this one more time. I hope. Okay, so basically this is one of the so basically what happens is basically when I try to run this command, so you would see all these data samples which is populated. So this is as simple as what it could get when you try to read the information. And you could do the similar thing with a client programmatically. Say for example, all I need to do is just provide a prices key and just a prices column family and a key, and what the column I'm trying to read, it should be able to get you the data what you're trying to fetch. Instead of that, say let's assume we are trying to read the hotel prices for, say, multiple keys for, say, multiple dates. So you can always use the slices of that data using slice predicates. These are the some of the things what we'll be focusing on the upcoming classes, where to use the slice predicates and how to use slice predicates, how to get the range slices, and these are the some of the things which you will be using it for your real-time applications. I just gave a quick sneak peek of what things are at this point of time, so we'll be spending much more time when we get into the later classes. So I think there seems to be some glitch on my local server, so I'll try to fix it and get you the exact things at a later point of time. For now, let's try to see if we got any further questions on my screen. Okay, so since we have got a few more minutes, so feel free to just put across any questions, anything which is not clear, or where I can just make sure to clear some of the concepts. Okay, so since we have some of the concepts and basics covered, I thought maybe it's a good option for us to just quickly go ahead and see how did we consume the content and what is the understanding. So I would appreciate if you all participate in a quick poll. I'm launching a couple of polls, so just make sure you all participate and provide your answers, so that helps me feel comfortable that how much we got through these concepts. Okay, so meanwhile, when we are all of us participating in the poll, there is one question from Sushil Nagur asking, is Java mandatory to use here, or it's flexible to use any query language? So Java is just one of the languages you can use to interact with Cassandra. It's absolutely not mandatory. You can use any other modern language like C Sharp, Perl, anything which you are comfortable with, and use the same libraries what those particular languages provide for the Thrift implementation or SQL to interact with Cassandra. Okay, so I think majority of them have voted. I got 70% of the votes, so there are still some people who said Cassandra is not schema free. So by definition, there is no strong or strict rules what is right or wrong. By definition, Cassandra is more of a flexible schema-free data storage. It doesn't restrict you to have fixed columns or a fixed rows kind of a model, fixed data types. At runtime, you can go and add any number of columns, or at runtime, you can change the column family, data types, and those are all the flexibilities. So technically speaking, it is not stringent or rigid on schema or on syntax of the data storage or the data model. So it is in fact schema free. That's how it has been treated as. Okay, so I think since we don't have any further questions, I would thank each and everyone for joining this session. Appreciated all the great questions from you all. And please make sure you provide your valuable feedback, and I'll pass it on to one of